What's up, everyone? Welcome back to Let's Play Demon Souls. I'm back in the 5-2 swamp, making my way through the second half of this level. If everything goes right, then this will be the finale to the Demon Souls playthrough. Now, these two giant depraved ones over here, I don't think you can actually avoid fighting them. There might be a way if you go the long way and do kind of a semi-circle around the swamp from here. I think you might be able to avoid them. I'm not sure if you have to actually get close to them to get up the ramp to continue progressing through the level. Either way, I don't really intend to find out here. I always engage these two. My plan is always to kite them way back into a big landmass so I don't have to fight them in the swamp itself. And I'm more than willing to take the time and just take it slow and lead them back into a more favorable position. My first attempt was not a stunning success. You can see a fog gate in the distance, so I'm just going to try to bait them back one more time. Also, I'm going to go ahead and put the Dragonbone Smasher on, and I'm probably going to need to take the Thief's Ring off to put the Ring of Great Strength on, because the whole point of luring them out away from the planks and onto one of the bigger islands that you can actually fight them on is so that I can roll properly. No sense spending all this time painstakingly kiting them back if I can't roll against them. So that's what I'm going to do. So while I'm trying to lure them back, I'll talk a little bit about Saylin Vinland. So before I mention that Saylin Vinland makes her home in the swamp, at least for now, temporary home, she's camped out in the swamp in search of her brother, Garl Vinland, because she has an important message for Garl. So, like I said, she only spawns in pure white world tendency, and she has a side quest for us. We have to get the Vinland family crest off of her brother's body, and that is her Black Phantom brother's body. And Black Phantom Garl Vinland, unlike all the other phantoms, only spawns in pure white world tendency as opposed to the other ones who spawn in pure black. I am just getting tossed around. Bad rolls. So once we give her the family crest and complete the side quest, she will give us a Ring of Devout Prayer, which is a ring that you can actually get outside of the side quest, so it's not necessary to complete. It is... let's see. Actually, it's not even the easiest way to go about getting that ring, because there is also a Ring of Devout Prayer. Wait, am I thinking of... No, I'm thinking of the other one. So the other way is you can get the Ring of Devout Prayer, or you can trade the Moonlight Greatsword, or what's it called in this game again? I always mix them up. It's the Large Sword of Moonlight, which you get in this level from the Slug Nest, which I'll be getting in a little bit. And you can also get one by killing Saint Urbane. So actually, her side quest kind of is the easiest way to get a Ring of Devout Prayer without killing an NPC who you need to buy miracles from. And what the Ring of Devout Prayer does, it functions in a similar way to another ring we got, the Ring of Magical Nature, which we got from when we rescued Yuria. It was up in the tower. And both of them increase the number of spells and or miracles you can store. The Ring of Magical Nature gives you an extra spell slot. The Ring of Devout Prayer gives you an extra miracle slot. But since I'm a mostly melee user, that's not going to be getting a lot of screen time or a lot of use from me. I still kind of want it though. And I have two bosses left in this world to push towards pure white world tendency. So I guess after I beat Maiden Astraea and finish this world out, I'll go back real quick and just do this side quest, and then we could start the end game. So I really would like this guy to stop getting stuck on the geometry. So I'm going to clear a path for him and get poisoned in the process, but I still have my Regenerator's Ring on. I still have the Adjudicator's Shield. Let's see, I'm doing... looks like about 20% damage a hit to him. I'll be just fine fighting him. I could two-hand it. I probably should have, but... on the off chance I do block a little bit, then it's worthwhile. I'll still take 10% of the damage from a hit that I block, and I can't remember if I'll still get knocked down. But it's worth the chance, it's worth the trade-off. Now I can go back to my normal setup, pull the Blessed Mace out, and start that health regeneration right up. And I'm not going to be using the Thief's Ring anymore for a moment. Actually, no. Oh, right, I didn't take it off. Now I'm going to mess with my ring setup. I thought I had taken it off. Oh well, that's what I get for not paying attention. So these small depraved ones over here that have the purplish fog surrounding them. Ooh, they actually got me there. Doesn't matter though. They cast Poison Cloud on you. It's pretty much the same as the player Poison Cloud that you get from, I believe that was Leechmonger's Soul. But since one, the swamp is poisoned and we are already poisoned, it's not like it's doing any kind of stacking damage to us. Or texture glitches. I'm making that sound like a really big deal with this higher inflection. Have to be a little bit careful around here. Oh.
Hey, won't you buy something, my poop?
Is there anything I want from this woman? Shard of Faint Stone. I don't want that just yet, though.
This place, it's a proper mound of rubbish. All the rot of the world, living or not, ends up here. I thank the stars that I still have my boy. Ever since that demon witch came here, everything has turned foul. This was a much better place before she came. I was the apple of every man's eye. You're here to rid us of her, aren't you? Well, don't show her any mercy. I thank the stars that... Finished already? You wretched penny pincher. Just let the children of the poor die, is that it?
So the filthy woman vendor in the Valley of Defilement continues to show us maybe another side of Maiden Astraea. Although I think she's just kind of embittered. Everyone seems kind of keen on judging Astraea as horrible just based on the idea that she might have become a demon or that she might have sacrificed her sainthood to pledge herself to a demon soul. Of course, all the ones back in the Nexus hope that these are only vile rumors, but they don't really seem to believe that a demon can still be pure and good in the eyes of their god, which we've revealed to be the old one that they're worshipping. Break made a comment that they were wrong to assume only demons could do demon work, so I think it also raises the question, does the inverse hold true? If humans can do demon work, can demons do as humans do? Can they be pure of heart? What about the Maiden in Black? We know that she was once considered to be the most dangerous and evil of demons, but now she tends the candles in the Nexus and takes care of the warriors who battle back the Old One's minions. Did the Monumentals punish her by occluding her eyes in wax and binding her to the Nexus where she serves for eternity? After all, she seems to always return from death if you try to kill her. Or at least, she does in the Nexus. And outwardly, she lives among the magicians and the church disciples on either side of the Nexus and cohabitates with them just fine. This is one of the reasons I find the Valley of Defilement to be so interesting. One of the many reasons that I think it's one of my favorite levels. Because it's through Astraea, a saint, it epitomizes that core conflict of the game, the church and the soul arts, the humans and the demons, good and evil, and what the line between the two really is. The series, in my opinion, and this goes for Dark Souls as well, is about power and the corruption of those who seek it. You know, absolute power corrupts absolutely. But the themes that it uses to explore that topic have always interested me. A big running theme of both Demon Souls and Dark Souls has always been duality and disparity. It's slightly less overt here than in Dark Souls, where the intro has the narrator outright saying, "And with the fire came disparity, heat and cold, life and death, and of course, light and dark." And it explores this kind of nebulous moral middle ground in a way that isn't exactly thorough, but that narrative theme is certainly always there, under the surface at least. More so than people like to give the game credit for. And part of that's due to the fact that people don't really see it as having a story, by which they usually mean the plot is really insubstantial. And I would argue there is a lot of story there, but not a lot of exposition. I once made the mistake when I reviewed Dark Souls in October of 2011 of making a similar accusation that it didn't have a story. And that's not really the case. Like I said, it doesn't have a straightforward plot, but it does tell a lot of stories. But you really have to search them out. And the same goes for Demon Souls. It is a bit like putting a giant puzzle together, a jigsaw puzzle, where each piece is scattered around an enormous city, and you have to find each individual piece before you can even begin to start putting it all together. Also, look at something like Limbo, a game which I did a more narrative-focused Let's Play of. There is no plot to Limbo, and yet there is clearly a lot to it. Also, I should mention, if you want to absorb more of the story of Demon Souls, a good place to start would be checking out all of the item descriptions that you come across and paying attention to things like where are they placed. And once you get to this point in the Valley of Defilement 5-2, you're really on a mostly straightforward path. There aren't a whole lot of alternate pathways to get thrown off on. You can mostly go one way. It looks kind of confusing and vertical, but it's pretty straightforward. The only time it gets a little harder to navigate is if you fall off the ramp here, or the little shanty town, into the swamp, and then you just have to do what you did in the second level of the Tower of Latria in the swamp there, and just find your way back up to the ramp. But I think there are more ramps here, and they're a lot easier to spot if you just run along the left edge. It's got, like, a much more straightforward layout. I actually think the swamp in the Tower of Latria, I think I said this already, but even though it's more compact, it's also a little bit more difficult to navigate if you get thrown into the swamp. Or, I mean, if you choose to move out into the swamp, there's not really a whole lot of ways to get thrown into it. Even the alternate pathways here, or the side paths that take you off to a few collectible items, even those don't really make this any less of a linear path. There is a shortcut path coming up. I'm trying to find it real quick. Looks like it's... yep, to the left here is where the boss is. If you keep moving forward, you come to a series of ramps and a series of planks that follows the left edge of the wall back to the beginning of the level. And if you remember, there is a bridge facing the opposite end of the place where we started. and this is how you get to that bridge and open up the shortcut by dropping it. So I'm just going to do that real quick. In case the unlikely happens and I somehow die to the dirty colossus, I'm pretty sure a lot of bosses have killed me over the many times I played this game. Dirty Colossus, I'm pretty sure, has never done me in before, so hopefully I am not afflicting myself with the Spelunky curse here. That would be really, really unfortunate. Actually, you know what? Both the Leechmonger and the Dirty Colossus are bosses that have never killed me, so... Is there any others? Yeah, there are a couple others, actually. Fool's Idol, it's pretty hard to die on, even in high New Game Pluses. Fool's Idol... Phalanx has actually killed me before. My first time playing, what I did was I didn't know what I was doing. I wasn't paying attention to the messages people were leaving me. So I burned through all of my Turpentine. I was playing a melee character, which is notoriously much harder compared to ranged classes, at least in Demon Souls. They balance out a little better in Dark Souls. So I was playing a melee-oriented character, and I burned through all of my Turpentine before I hit Phalanx. And I was just wildly unprepared for how to deal with that fight, so I think I died 2 times in a row on Phalanx the first playthrough. Tower Knight was also another one that I think killed me a couple times the first time I played Demon Souls. He does a lot more damage than you might expect. Actually, no, he does exactly as much as you would expect, given how fucking huge he is. Here we go, this is the path to the shortcut. It's pretty much just one long, narrow trek along these planks. With not much in the way except a couple annoying mosquitoes. They go down, no problem. Be careful with the camera here and the way the mosquitoes float off. If you take a swing with the wrong weapon, you'll take a couple steps forward and just fall into the swamp, and I believe you are... It's weird, but you are high enough to die from fall damage for some reason. Maybe it just has to do with the way the swamp physics works, where you don't actually have to be that high up to die to falling damage. So yeah, there's just a couple mosquitoes and a few regular garden variety stab you in the face. Depraved ones. And jump up here. There we go. I believe it's only a couple more feet. I was wrong. Now we still got a little bit of distance to cover. And another one of you guys. For shame on you. For shame. I would always recommend against chasing that lizard down. It is not going to be a good time for anyone. So, just let him get away. Doesn't even matter. Okay. Let us start the Dirty Colossus boss fight. I've already, exposed my theories about Dirty Colossus being Beto the Moonlight Knight. So, not gonna backtrack through that territory. Instead, I'm gonna talk about the way the fight works. So, the Dirty Colossus has one main gimmick. Flies! Flies are the gimmick of the Dirty Colossus. He will do a couple attacks that can coat you in a nice fur coat of flies. He can do an AoE attack where he charges up for a little bit. It's point blank, and you can easily outrange it with a simple roll backwards. He will occasionally pound the ground and create a cloud of flies in the area where he pounds. And he, like you just saw, also shoots flies in volleys of 3 or 4. And when you get coated in flies, you have to run to one of the lit braziers around the arena and burn the flies off. You also take a little bit of damage from that action, and you take a noticeable amount of damage every second. It looks like about half-second ticks for the damage. Yeah. It doesn't... You can't just regenerate your way through it. Even if you have the Blessed Mace, the Regenerator's Ring, and the Adjudicator's Shield all equipped at once, you're going to take too much damage over time to completely negate the effect of the flies. So, I would just rather not get hit by it that frequently. Oh, son of a bitch! That's the one thing... You can kind of get caught in a loop with this fight. I don't know why I can't hit the brazier. Gonna roll to another one. It's the one thing about this fight. Once you get far enough away from the dirty Colossus to burn the flies off, if it happens at all, you can kind of get stuck in a loop where you burn the flies off, you run away to get back to him, and he's shooting volleys at you. Even if you're running to the side, sometimes you'll get nicked or grazed by the flies. There's the ground pound that creates a big cloud of flies. Sometimes you'll get nicked and you'll just be in a loop where you're so far away that he's just going to keep spamming you with fly missiles. Fly missiles! And then up close, all he has is three attacks. He can do one swipe at a time, or he can do up to a three-hit combo. He can also do the AoE attack I was talking about. Oh god, and he shot me. He seems to do the ranged fly attack whenever you are outranging his melee attacks by a decent amount. Yep, gonna eat some grass. This is what I'm talking about with the loop. You have to stagger it a little bit in order to avoid that happening. So if you wait just a half a second to burn them off, you can avoid getting caught in a loop. So yeah, he can do one or two attacks, he can do up to three in a row as a combo, he can do the ground pound, that's about it. His limbs are also slightly armored. You have to break the armor off before you can start doing real damage to him. Oh, jeez. This is not only the Spelunky curse in effect here. This is just generally the Let's Player's curse. Where everything just seems to go as wrong as possible. I didn't realize the R2 swing actually had a little bit of invincibility frames on it. If it didn't, I would have gotten hit by his last attack while I was going in for a swing. That is not where the invincibility frames were, though. Also, that's a really... Oh, God. No pun intended, a dirty trick. Oh, man. But that's the Dirty Colossus fight in a nutshell. Not a hard fight at all. I believe I've said that about almost every boss except like two or three. Like I said, Demon Souls is not... It has a reputation for being much, much more difficult than it actually is. And don't get me wrong, I fucked up a lot there. It is difficult to do perfectly, but to just succeed, it takes patience more than anything else. It takes patience, the ability to learn on the fly, which, granted, that's not a skill everyone has. And if you just take it slow and steady and pay attention, you'll usually be fine. Just don't rush in and do anything stupid. But with that out of the way, we can do the Maiden Astraea fight now, 5-3, and finish out World 3. And then a little bit of side stuff to do, and we can start the endgame. If you're wondering why I just equipped a shitty little... Night Shield instead of my awesome Purple Flame Shield or the Adjudicator Shield, it's because the quickest way to do this fight is through parrying, and because I've spent the whole game talking about how much I love the control scheme, how good the combat is, how awesome parrying is, and yeah, I've spent the whole game pretty much with the Purple Flame Shield on, which is a Shield Bash Shield that cannot perform a parry. So, I want to close this out in style, and I also want to do the Garl Vinland fight as efficiently as possible, which is to parry Garl Vinland's giant hits.
Go forth, Galvinland. May you be unharmed. Leave us, Slayer of Demons. This is a sanctuary for the lost and wretched. There is nothing here for you to pillage or plunder. Please, leave quietly.
You will not turn back. I shall let no harm come to you. May you rot in the deepest depths of this swamp.
So we finally have the revelation that the boss fight is not really against Astraea herself. Wow, this is going poorly already. The boss fight is more against Garl Vinland.
You abandoned us long ago.
And the easiest way to go about doing this fight is to simply parry him over and over again. Ooh. Because you can see he does a lot of damage. Even if you partially reduce the damage he's doing on the swing with a missed parry, you're still going to take some heavy hits, you're going to get knocked down, and he's retreating. Wonderful. So let's talk about 5-3 in the valley. This part of the Valley of Defilement takes place in a swamp full of aborted babies who rise from the depths to attack you once you enter it. And you are also plagued if you spend just a little bit of time in the swamp. And plague is a much, much worse version of poison. So that last fight didn't go too well. Let's try it again. Thankfully, it put my bloodstain up here instead of forcing me to go all the way back down. Man, my parry timing sucks! That's what I get for spending like 18 hours over the course of this playthrough not parrying, is I lose all my sense of timing. There we go. So with a strong enough weapon, and on a new playthrough, it only takes a few hits to actually kill Garl Vinland. Also, I'm not going to be needing to roll quickly anymore, so I'll de-equip my Ring of Great Strength and put the Ring of Herculean Strength on so I can carry more. You get all of Garl Vinland's armor and his Dark Silver Shield, which is one of the best shields in the entire game. For beating him, you do not get his weapon just yet. So I was talking when I died about the swamp. It is a plagued swamp that is filled with blood and aborted babies.
You killed him, didn't you? Very well. I can no longer resist you. Do as you like. Take your precious demon soul.
And just like Astraea, Maiden Astraea kills herself. And she makes her home amongst the foulest of the fetter in the Valley of Defilement, amidst the diseased swamp full of aborted fetuses. How is that for intense and dark and disturbing? I love everything about that fight, that moment, that level. Just gonna level up real quick. Oh shit.
The old one is calling for thee. Let us proceed below to its lair.
Brought thee what thou wishest, thy new demon. Come now, be good.
That's not good. Okay, gonna look for the endgame archstone because I do believe that is a thing, and I will be right back in a sec. So, I fucked up pretty bad. I forgot that talking to the Maiden in Black once all five worlds were clear automatically triggers the endgame, and I went to her thinking I'm gonna spend those last few souls, then I'll do some side quests, and some tendency events, and I thought there was an archstone in the endgame area, so you weren't locked in, but I couldn't find it. So we're just gonna roll with it. But you know what? A curse into a blessing. We're gonna make the most of this colossal failure. I've been wondering whether or not to do a bonus episode and what I would include in it, and since I've already gone so far out of my way collecting stuff, I'm gonna do something special for the bonus episode, something that has eluded me. I'm gonna do several New Game Plus playthroughs and fucking platinum this shit.
You have been chosen by the Old One. Shalt thou seek everlasting demon souls? Obey that naive monumental. Whatever your choice, you are our first visitor. You'll be welcome here. Surely you have seen for yourself the pain, suffering that fills this world. But fight poison with poison. God is merciful. And so I created the Old One. The Old One will feed upon our souls and put an end to our tragic realm of existence.
And this is the final boss. This is King Alant himself after he has tried to grasp at the power of the Old One and failed miserably. He is the embodiment of everything this game has been leading to. He is the failed mad quest for power, embodied in this decrepit, deformed, demonic body. And as you can see, it's not much of a fight. It's gonna end quite quickly, and it's going to be the only fight in the game, I think, that ends without seeing me take a scratch. But its symbolic value is much greater than its value as a challenging fight. And before I finish this off, why don't I just go ahead, taunt him, and take a running start.
You fool. Don't you understand? No one wishes to go on.
This all ties in quite well with what I'm talking about with Maiden Astraea. And once you kill him, you can finally claim the Soul Brand for yourself. Remember, it was King Alant's favored weapon because it scales with pure black world tendency. Unlike the one we got from Old King Durin, which is the opposite. Now that we have both of the swords and the False King's Demon Soul, we can, in New Game Plus, make the Northern Regalia.
Thine work is done. Slayer of demons, go back above. The Nexus shall imprison thee no longer.
So since it ties in so well with what I was just saying, I'm going to keep talking about Maiden Astraea in through the credits, even through the credits, and we'll pick the good ending.
The Old One and I shall slumber interminably. That is the way it must be. Thou mayst go. Be gone to thine world.
The way you get the good ending is you exit through the fog gate in the back after you talk to the Maiden in Black. The way you get the bad ending is by killing the Maiden in Black.
At last, my duty is fulfilled.
And should I kill her? Or should I actually take the good ending? Nah, let's take the good ending for now. I'll show the other ending off in the bonus episode. Speaking of the bonus episode, I just want to clear that up real quick after the cutscene. Also, the Old One totally looks like Lavos from Chrono Trigger if Lavos was made of trees. And he's even in the same ocean setting.
The Old One, along with the Maiden, were swept back into the lulling fog. Boletaria was spared from the demons, but also lost its knowledge of soul arts. The souls lost during the pandemonium were never retrieved. And today, the unstable world has another monumental to hold its fabric together. A brave new hero of unprecedented power.
And that is how Demon Souls ends. At least in the good ending. And even the good ending is a blessing unto a curse. I personally love it. Demon Souls is about the perils of coveting power. It disfigured Alant and warped his mind and left him wondering whether or not it would be best to fight poison with poison and destroy the corruption entirely by ripping up the roots, letting the Old One wipe the slate clean and purge humanity to end its suffering. Sure, it's an old trope, the baptism and fire thing, but it works pretty well here. So for the bonus episode, obviously I'm not going to be doing like 60 more episodes and call them all bonus episodes. So what I'm gonna do, I think, is to 100% the game and get the platinum. I'm obviously gonna do 3 more playthroughs, but I will cut everything up, do some post commentary, and show the acquisition of every miracle, spell, item upgrade, some farming tricks, and whatnot, do every side quest that I missed, and all the Black Bantams, all the World Tendency events, everything I said I wasn't going to do in episode 1 and the other ending. So let's keep talking about Astraea for the short credit roll here. When you first enter 5-3, Astraea tells us that there's nothing here for us to pillage or plunder, and asks us to leave. And she indicts us for this callous lust for power, this blind quest. We don't know what killing her is going to do exactly, but we do it anyway. Did you notice how Girl Vinland wasn't the aggressor in that fight either? He only attacked when you approached him. Or when we approached him, when I approached him, whatever. When we threatened to harm Astraea. By the way, you can snipe her with a bow and arrow from one of the positions in the valley higher up. Even the enemies here don't attack. They're here to worship and praise the pristine and pure gift that has blessed them, that has come to cure them and help them. Astraea, who took on the role of a demon not to do harm, not to take from them, to further disenfranchise them, but to do good. She became impure to cleanse the Valley of Defilement, a place which was created when the elite of Boletaria needed a place to cast their unwanted babies, to do away with the decrepit and the sick burdening them, and thus transform the valley into a wretched and filthy place. And then along comes Astraea, and we kill her. We kill her. And why? Because the Old One has to be stopped? She has to die for that to happen? Meanwhile, we have no sense of whether or not that quest is just or right. All we know is collecting demon souls makes us more powerful. And that is the only absolute truth that we have up to that point. Even Sage Frake questions the morality of not... of killing the Old One. He doesn't actually question the morality of it. In fact, he encourages us to further seek power. He and Urbane kind of have an angel and devil on your shoulder dynamic leading up to the ending choice of whether or not you kill the maiden and try to take power for yourself, or whether or not you walk away and let the maiden lull the Old One back to slumber. But even Frake seems to at least be aware that there might be more going on than what meets the eye. The crestfallen Blue Phantom also questions the Monumental's endeavors and the decision to try to lull the Old One back to sleep. He isn't quite as fanatical as Frake in telling us to just take power for yourself, much like Alaunt did to trigger this whole mess. But those two NPCs in particular seem to indicate that there's more going on than what we're being told. Everyone wants souls for different reasons, and souls represent power, and it's even baked into the leveling system. And we are finally at the end here, at least for the main playthrough. Thank you guys for watching, take it easy, have a good one, and I will see you guys in the bonus episode.